So welcome friends, back after a short commercial break, let me put it that way. And now we are on to the AS-18 related party disclosures. I can tell you from your perspective, it may not be as important. But from the perspective of the private bodies, even private educational institutions, it is probably one of the most significant standards. If I have to ask a very simple question to you all, suppose there are two sets of financial statements which have been given to you. In one set of financial statements, it has been disclosed that 70 to 80% of the transactions of the enterprise are with the parties which are related with this enterprise. And in the other one, there is no transaction, such transaction. In which financial statements will you like to place greater reliance? The answer is naturally where there is no such related party transaction. Because there is a concept called arm's length transaction. When you are transacting with the related party, the general presumption is that probably, I will not say that 100% it has happened, but probably it has happened that there could be some diversion of profit or losses here or there from one party to another party, and the transactions may not be free and fair. Basically, and could be really with a different intent altogether. This is one standard which requires disclosures of such transactions so that you are able to understand the financial statements better. You are able to understand and appreciate the transactions of this enterprise with its own related parties. And also the quantum thereof, not only the transactions, but even the quantum thereof, you will be able to understand or will be able to appreciate it much better in that particular sense. So this is called AS-18, that related party disclosures. And if you ask me what are the related party disclosures, but before that, as I said, this entire accounting standard goes on to explain you and establish the requirements for disclosure of related party relationships. Number one, you must be able to establish whether the other party is related to the enterprise or not. If yes, what kind of a relationship it has got. And secondly, you must disclose the transactions between a reporting enterprise and its related parties. As we move on, you will come through some of the very interesting features. This particular standard deals with the following related party relationships. See, what is the related party relationship? Number one, I think you all understand the concept of subsidiary. I don't think any one of you doesn't understand the concept of the subsidiary. Subsidiary is an enterprise wherein the holding enterprise owns 50% plus one share. It is not necessarily 51%. It is 50% plus one share. That gives them the right to control you, basically. Or it has the ability to govern, to control the composition of the governing body. In your case, I am not using the word board of directors. I am using the word to control the composition of the governing body, basically. And thirdly, if there is a significant influence also. Now, definition of the term subsidiary as per this particular standard is different from the definition of the term subsidiary as per AS-21. Which deals with the consolidation of the financial statements. I will explain what that difference is later on. So this says enterprise it deals with the related party relation. Enterprises that directly or indirectly, through one or more intermediaries, control or are controlled by or are under the common control with the reporting enterprise. This includes holding companies, subsidiaries and fellow subsidiaries. What it is trying to say is, suppose there is a company A, I can say there is a university A or there is an educational institution A, which invests in another university or another educational institution, either on its own or by a special purpose vehicle created by it. So directly or indirectly, because this SPV will become a special purpose, it will become an intermediary if you ask me. If it does that and brings the other university or other educational institution under the common control, then it is a related party relationship. In Hindi, we sometimes call it gucha companies, basically. There are so many layers. Now in the Companies Act, it has been said that you cannot have more than two-layered subsidiary companies. Whereas earlier, if you ask me, you would forget the number of the subsidiaries which will be there. Subsidiary of a subsidiary, subsidiary of a subsidiary, subsidiary of a subsidiary, and then holding company remains holding for each one of those companies. Probably one holding company might be having 50 or 100 of the subsidiary companies. And you could have the multi-layered, but now under the Companies Act, they have said that you cannot go beyond two layers. And that's a very positive step, because the trail of the money was not being known otherwise. It was very difficult to establish the trail of the money, where the money was going. So that is why it has been now restricted to the two layers under the Companies Act. Now, it could be a holding company and it could be a subsidiary. I have already explained what is the definition of. Now, fellow subsidiaries, what I explained to you. Now, if A has got B as a subsidiary and C as a subsidiary, then B and C are the fellow subsidiaries, basically. If A has got B as a subsidiary and also C as a subsidiary, then both of them become fellow subsidiaries amongst themselves, basically. That is what the relationship is, which would mean that even if B and C will deal with each other, these transactions will have to be reported as related party relationships. That is the intent of this. In the lighter vein, I can say that a teacher was teaching, because every time this logic doesn't work. A teacher was teaching and he said that this glass is on the table is on the earth. So logically, the table is on the earth, or the glass is on the earth. And then he said that A is equal to B and B is equal to C. So logically, A is equal to C. And then he asked a student from the back, he said, can you give me an example of this kind of a logic? And the student got up and said, sir, I love you and you love your daughter. What a beautiful logic he gave. So sometimes the logic may work, sometimes the logic may not work. But the fact remains that people can apply logic very innovatively also. So fellow subsidiaries, if A, B and C, as I said, even if they will transact anything amongst themselves, that would become a transaction between the related party. Associates and joint ventures. Joint venture is something which is under the joint control. You float something. Now, if you start a particular entity for the purpose of specialized courses, you are not running the specialized courses under you, but along with another one, you start something by way of specialized courses and you have a joint control with the other person concerned, it is your joint venture with an economic objective that you want to make profits out of it, basically. The assets can be controlled by you, the operations can be controlled by you. So it will become your joint venture, and associate is one which is not a joint venture, which is not a subsidiary, but you have a significant influence. And significant influence is generally presumed the moment you have 20% or more of the share capital in the other entity, it is presumed that you have the significant influence It is a presumption. Let me be very clear. I will come to the other part because it is a rebuttable presumption at the end of the day. But if there is an associate of yours or there is a joint venture of yours, whatever transactions you carry out with them, those transactions will be treated as related party transactions. Then comes the individuals. There are certain individuals with whom you will deal. These will be considered to be related party transactions. There could be individuals who, by virtue of their shareholding, not otherwise, by virtue of their shareholding, they may or may not be directors. By virtue of their shareholding, they are able to control the operations. In that particular case also, they will also be considered to be the related party. Or their relatives further. How their relative is defined, to that we will come little later. Even their relatives will be considered to be a related party vis-a-vis this particular enterprise. So if this particular person, individual owning directly or indirectly an interest in the voting power of the reporting enterprise that gives them control or significant influence, it means if he has got 20% or more or 50% or more, in both the circumstances, he will be considered to be a related party. But he must have the voting power. That's very important. If you have the share capital, which does not carry the voting power, in that particular case, that control is lost. Because today, you can have shares with the disproportionate voting rights in the companies. In the educational institutions, you may not be having that kind of situation. But in the companies, that situation is there. The key managerial personnel. Now, the key managerial personnel will mean basically MDs and the managing director and the whole-time director, as per the definition here. Because as I move along, but before I move along, I will just define two of the terms here. One is the term relative. Relative under this particular standard has been defined 7 direct relationships. Mother, father, brother, sister, son, daughter, spouse. Just 7 relationships. There is no other relationship which is considered to be relative. As per this particular accounting standard, I am repeating again, 7 relationships are considered to be relatives of individuals. Mother, father, son, daughter, brother, sister, spouse, who can influence or may have the ability to influence your decisions. That's very important to note. If an individual who is a relative of yours cannot influence your decision, he will not be considered to be a related party. If husband and wife are in court of law, they are contesting a case for separation, they have not divorced so far. The relationship still exists, husband and wife, but they cannot influence each other. So they will not be considered to be related parties. Brother, if the two brothers are fighting with each other in the court of law for the property or for any other matter, can they influence any of the decision making? The answer is no. Because it says who may have the ability to influence. That's very important. Then only you will be considered to be a relative with whom the transaction can be considered to be a related party transaction. You may continue to be a relative in the definition of the relative. But if you are unable to influence, or you do not have the capacity to influence the decision of the other, then you lose out that particular prerogative of being considered as a related party transaction. That's very, very important. And I can tell you, right now we are dealing with the Indian law. The moment IFRS comes in, International Financial Reporting Standards will come in, we have the term spouse. They do not have the term spouse at all. They have the term domestic partner. And they have the term, how they say, your children, children of the domestic partner and children of both. This is the cultural difference which makes difference in the accounting standards. They don't use the word spouse. They say domestic partner. And then when they talk about children, they say children of the domestic partner, your children and children of both. As and when IFRS will be implemented in India, this definition will undergo a change so far as the relative is concerned. From spouse, the definition will be domestic partner, and I always say jocularly that somewhere or the other, we have not been influenced by the serials of Ekta Kapoor, otherwise we could have said spouses, not spouse. Basically, because you look at, you watch any of our TV serials, what happens is, I don't have to tell you that. And another thing that we have been very, very clear about is that laws are very complex and in-laws are the most complex. So we have kept them out of this particular definition in the accounting standard. But at the same time, what has happened is that now the relative has been defined under Companies Act, the new Companies Act. There the definition is much wider compared to this. And we now in the accounting standard itself have said that wherever the statute which governs you has a different definition, then that definition has to be followed. There probably some in-laws relationships will come in. Because today I have been talking, in all my seminars I have been talking, don't deal with mother, deal with mother-in-law, it is not to be reported. Don't deal with your father, deal with father-in-law, the transaction is not to be reported. Don't deal with brother, deal with your brother-in-law, the transaction is not to be reported. But in the Companies Act, probably you will be caught somewhere. So it's not all that simple, basically. And another thing that you have to be very, very clear about is, when it comes to the definition of key managerial personnel, that's the KMP. KMPs have been defined as, under this particular accounting standard, those individuals who have the authority and responsibility, please mind my words, who have the authority and responsibility for planning, directing and controlling the operational and financial policies of the enterprise. So if in your cases, you might be the GM, but you may not be able to govern any of the policy. You may be probably the top man in finance, but you cannot govern the policy. What is important is you must have the authority and responsibility both. If either of the two limbs is missing, you have the authority, but you don't have the responsibility, then you are out of the definition of key managerial personnel. And if you have the authority and responsibility, but you don't have the control, then also you are out of it, basically. So what is very, very important to be understood is, you cannot be considered to be a key managerial personnel for the purpose of related party transactions unless you have the authority and responsibility for planning, directing and controlling the activities. In the case of a bank, a GM in the bank will be considered to be a very, very high post. But because after that is only ED and CMD, he is amongst the top 20 employees out of 50,000 employees in the company, in the bank, if you ask me. But he is not a key managerial personnel from the angle of this particular standard. Because he cannot have the authority, he has the responsibility. He does not sit on the board. But every director also doesn't have the authority. Because if he has the authority, he doesn't have the responsibility. A non-executive director, an independent director on the board, may have the authority to sit on the board and to decide, but he doesn't have the responsibility in the day-to-day activities to carry on, to discharge any of the obligations. So that's very important. Please be very, very clear so far as the definition under this particular standard is concerned. It defines key managerial personnel as one who has the authority and responsibility for planning, directing and controlling the activities of the policies of the organization. But fortunately or unfortunately now, in the Companies Act, the key managerial personnel definition has been changed altogether. Even a GM who may not have any authority will still become the key managerial personnel. Why I'm trying to emphasize on these definitions is because whatever transactions you carry on with these people and the relatives of these people, those will have to be reported as the related party transactions. Earlier in the accounting standard, now you are no more a company, so you can still be away from it. And this particular standard again is applicable only to the class level 1 entities, which we have already talked. But if you are a company, then it is applicable to you. If you are not a company, in that particular case, it is not applicable to you unless you are a level 1 company, level 1 enterprise. That is 50 crore and 10 crore. I am not expecting you to be a company in any case. But if you have a turnover of 50 crore above or you have a borrowing of 10 crore above, in that case it becomes applicable to you. You are not a company, I am very clear about it. So it is, in any case, you are not covered by that particular definition. So what is important to me is that the moment you have a key managerial personnel, now to you, since you are not a company, the definition under Companies Act cannot apply. To you, the definition which is given in the accounting standard will continue to apply. So your chief accountant may be chief accountant, but he does not sit on the governing body. He has the responsibility but not the authority. So he will not be a key managerial personnel. So any transaction carried out with him or his relative will not be considered to be a related party transaction. Any questions on this? What I am trying to bring to your knowledge is, people may have a perception that he is a very high level officer and any transaction with him will be a related party transaction, but that's not the case. Or with his relative may be a related party transaction, but it may be not.
Is it applicable?
If you are saying that accounting standards are applicable to you, then it becomes applicable to you.
How we will apply it?
No, I'm only talking about that basically. You see, in your case, it will not be applicable from the viewpoint of subsidiaries,
yes,
from the viewpoint of joint venture, from the viewpoint of associate. But joint venture is possible. I'm telling you particularly in the case of
joint venture.
If you float a joint venture or you create an associate, it might become applicable. But if you are a key managerial personnel, you sit on the governing body, you are the chairman of the governing body, you are definitely, whatever transactions take place between you, whatever fees even you get of sitting fee, whatever conveyance is paid to you, that has to be disclosed as a related party transaction.
So you explained the definition of the relatives. It includes father, mother, son, brother, daughter, brother, sister, yeah, and wife. And in IFRS, it is a domestic partner. Now there is a specific question.
Forget about domestic partner.
Anyway,
you shouldn't be interested.
Now I just want to know that son, definition of the son or daughter, whether adopted son or adopted daughter will be
absolutely,
will
absolutely,
be not genetically born.
Absolutely.
Sir, in the case
till the time he writes that he is your son, my father is so and so, and you write in your family he is my son, he is your son, as simple as that. Our accounting standard does not answer the question of illegitimate relationships, very frankly. In the Companies Act, even that is considered to be a relationship. I am answering that because you can ask that question. If it is proved today, N.D. Tiwari, if it is asked the question, he will have to declare him as a son. It is a related party transaction.
The son born out of illegitimate relationship is considered as a son only.
Son. That's what I am. So, my humble submission to you is, the moment you have gone through the adoption route and you have been writing everywhere that he is my son and he has been writing that you are his father, it is a son relationship. be clear. And it does not distinguish between married daughter or unmarried daughter. Whether it is a married daughter or unmarried daughter, the relationship remains the same.
Sir, in the case of Central University, Vice Chancellor will be the key personnel.
No, Vice Chancellor or certain other people sitting on the governing body?
The Executive Council, all members.
Yes, all members.
Then it will be very difficult.
Except the nominated members who do not have the responsibility to perform down.
But it is very difficult to get the particulars whether they are related to the Vice Chancellor or the Executive.
That is what I am trying to tell you, my friends. Whatever is your Executive Council today, or whatever is the governing body of the colleges, start obtaining the list of their relatives as per this particular accounting standard. And if there is any transaction with them, that has to be disclosed as a related party transaction. But more importantly, you know how much you have paid to them?
Yeah.
That has to be disclosed.
That is that.
Provided, but again I am saying, you cross the threshold limit of 50 crore or 10 crore borrowing. No. Only then, not otherwise.
Some of the professors who are Executive Council members, their wards are employed in the university on contractual employment. That should also be disclosed.
No. Again, I am saying, if you have taken somebody on a contractual basis, which is part-timer, he doesn't have the authority. That is why I was trying to define it very clearly. Authority and responsibility for planning, directing and controlling.
No, that's I am saying, some of the professors who are Executive Council members, they are taking the responsibility and they are taking the policy decisions.
Then they are definitely
Their wards are employed on contractual employment.
Yes, they are definitely covered by this.
They are definitely governed
definitely
by this.
Covered
that should be
this.
Disclosed.
Absolutely sure. See, the point is, if you say that they are in the Executive Council, they have been deployed, or their son is deployed, or their daughter is deployed, whatever payments are made to them or their relatives, those will have to be disclosed. But my biggest question is whether you are covered by that threshold limit of 50 crore or 10 crore borrowing. That's all. If you are covered there, then you are covered here. If you are not covered there, then there is no need.
I have a question.
Please.
In case of NITs and IITs, there are nominated members on the board. The chairman itself is a nominated member. And there are other nominated members from the ministry as well as the state government. Whether transactions made with them will be...
Again, I am repeating my basic question to you. Whether the chairman is a working chairman or only a chairman just for the purpose of the board meeting, there is a difference, because then he doesn't have the responsibility, he has only the authority. Vice chancellor has both the authority and responsibility. You see, in the companies also there are chairmen who are executive chairmen, who are non-executive chairmen. Non-executive chairman is not a related party, executive chairman is a related party.
Maximum chairmen are not there, they are only...
So they are only decorative pieces, basically, if you ask me. So if they are decorative pieces, then they are not the related part, to be covered by the related parties. But what is important you have to understand is, there are no specific transactions which are to be covered. Even if you pay them conveyance, you pay them salary, everything will be covered therein. Whatever payments you make to them, once he falls in the category of the related party as a key managerial personnel or otherwise, all those payments will have to be covered.
So these are the definitions of relatives. Now there can be some purchase decisions. When purchases are made by the company, those purchases can be from one of the relatives or their companies or their...
You have made a purchase from the relative of a key managerial personnel, you have to disclose it as a related party transaction, irrespective of the fact whether it is arm length or not.
How to know this information, sir? Because there...
That is the system that you have to devise. That is what I am asking you. Whosoever falls within the definition of key managerial personnel, please start taking a declaration from them who are their relatives and what businesses they are running and whether they are having any transactions with this particular entity or not. You will have to take it. In the companies also, at the beginning of the year, we are supposed to confirm who all are our relatives, which are the organizations in which we have got the interest, and if at all any transaction takes place, in the next board meeting, we have to say that this is the transaction which has taken place with this. In every company,
sir,
it happens.
Sir, he can recuse himself. There will be conflict of interest, so he can be aloof from the decision.
Recusing is a must in any case. Let's be very clear. But at the same time, he has to disclose, and this disclosure has to be made in the financial statements. His recusing does not help the non-disclosure.
But transaction itself is not questionable.
That is why we are not saying that the transaction will be questioned. Please try to understand. What we are trying to tell you is, I gave you an example to begin with. If there is a company in which 80% of the transactions are with the related party, it may or may not be arm's length. But let the reader of the financial statement know. We are not saying determine arm length. We are only saying, please look into this particular part and disclose it. Though if I go to the paragraph 23 of the standard, it talks of something else also. To that I will come little later.
Vice Chancellor has both authority and responsibility. Now, the wife of the Vice Chancellor is a dean of the university. She becomes a member of the Executive Council by dint of her capacity as dean. Does it also come under
both,
this?
Both are key managerial personnel in any case. So, I can only tell you, even if she had not become a dean, whatever payments were being made to her, if at all any payment was being made to her, that would have been disclosed as a transaction, related party transaction. And if she has become a dean and vice chancellor is there, both are the key managerial personnel in any case in their capacity. So the transactions with both will have to be disclosed.
May I again argue with you in one point?
Please.
In the case of companies, the owners and these persons have a ownership. But in case of universities, these by dint of their relation do not have any ownership. Does
Please
it not have any
appreciate.
Impact?
Please try to appreciate. Here we are not asking for a disclosure in the case of a shareholder alone. If you were exercising that control or significant influence, then that would have emerged under three. You see, first one was subsidiary, second one was joint venture associate, third one was the shareholder who was having the control or the significant influence. The fourth one was the key managerial personnel. Key managerial personnel need not be owner or shareholder. After all, an MD of a company is generally not the shareholder.
So education and universities are coming under that fourth clause,
under
key
the
managerial
fourth. They will get hit by the fourth and fifth. Because fifth says relatives of such individuals at the category 3 and the relatives of the people at the category 4. You see, A says, again I am repeating, A says holding subsidiary, B says joint venture associate, C says you are individual holding control or significant influence, 4 says key managerial personnel, 5th says relatives of such individuals or key managerial personnel. So you get hit by 4th and 5th, not by the 3rd. That is the point. So what is important for you to understand is that if you are in any of these 5 categories, in that particular case, the transactions with you have to be reported. The only solace that you can draw is probably one aspect you will not have to disclose, to which probably one will come little bit later. Parties are considered to be related. If at any point during this is, please read it very, very carefully. Parties are considered to be related if at any time during the reporting period one party has the ability to control the other party or exercise significant influence over the other party in making financial and or operating decisions. Control hai toh bhi, or if you can really influence the decision making with regard to the financial and operating policies, then also you will be considered to be the related party at any point of time. Ownership directly or indirectly or more than this I have already talked of. Substantial interest I have already said. Substantial interest will mean 20% or more of the share capital, basically, which is not applicable to you. When do you say that controlling the composition? Now, here it is possible that in your universities that might be there. If you create further sub-segments, now if you control the governing, the composition of the other governing body, suppose an IAM creates another subset of a body and the directors or the governing body is only to be nominated by IAM, then you will be considered to be controlling the composition of that particular governing body. If the power lies with you to nominate majority of the directors on that, by single director it doesn't make any difference. If out of three, every time two have to be nominated by you and no other decision can be taken by anybody, in that case that control lies with you. So it is not a control merely by the share capital. It is a control which you can derive by way of an agreement to nominate the people on the governing body, and that's very important. Have a substantial interest in other enterprises, wo maine already bol diya, key managerial personnel I have already said. See, this standard requires, but before I go to that, disclosure part I will go later. This standard says, what is a related party transaction? So far we have only covered the related party, but what is a related party transaction, that we need to understand. Related party transaction is something where there is a transfer of resource or obligation by one party to another, between the two related parties. Again, I am repeating, transfer of a resource or obligation with or without consideration. This is the most important aspect. Most important aspect. With or without consideration. What does it mean? If as a university you just say, okay, this particular person will be coming to you and will be delivering lectures, and that is a related party to you. The other party is a related party to you. Suppose it is your joint venture or associate. This particular person A is on your payroll. But he goes there and delivers the lectures and you don't charge him anything to the joint venture. You will still have to disclose this as a related party transaction. You will have to say A goes for delivering of the lecture. These many lectures he has delivered there. No charge has been made to the joint venture in respect thereof. Why? It has very serious implication. It has the implication that tomorrow income tax officer can turn around and say, why should I treat the expense of this particular man's salary as your expense, as your business expenditure? He says, I don't agree with it. I disallow this particular expenditure to you. Suppose you bought something. Suppose you bought the computer systems, because it is a resource also, no? Resource. After all, physical resource can be there, human resource can be there, any kind of a resource can be there. Now, you bought out something, you bought something and you allowed them the use of this computer system free of cost. The entire system of yours free of cost. And you had borrowed the funds, you are paying interest thereon. Tomorrow the assessing officer will say, why should I allow this particular interest expense as your expense, business expense? Because you have not gained, you have allowed your joint venture to take benefit of it. I disallow this particular expenditure. It is very much on cards, you can be sure about it. So it is not important that you should be charging and then only you have to report. Even if you don't charge something and it is your resource or obligation, if you stand guarantee for somebody, someone else has to take a loan and you say, okay, I stand guarantee for it. This is also a transaction which has to be reported. So it is not very simple very frankly. So people say, how do we really do it? It is absolutely clear that whenever there is a transfer of resource or obligation by one party to another party, which are related parties amongst themselves, it will be considered to be a related party transaction, and that related party transaction has to be reported. Irrespective of the fact whether you have charged anything in respect of this or you have not charged anything in respect of this. And not charging anything in respect of any such item is more dangerous. Now, it is very much possible that you have got a name. Suppose you as a university, you as an institution built up a name. And you allow somebody to use that particular name at ₹1 per annum. The income tax officer is going to be after you. How can you do it? You built a goodwill over the years. It means it is not an arm's length transaction. What is an arm's length transaction? Arm's length transaction is which has to be at a fair value. A transaction which should be undertaken by the two willing sellers or buyers at a rate which is market rate. And these buyers and sellers should be knowledgeable buyers and sellers. Both must be knowing the market conditions altogether. Now, if you transfer something at ₹1 as a franchise, as a brand to someone, tomorrow somebody is going to be after you. That is a related party transaction. And particularly if you are a private company, if you are a private institution, and you have gone for a public issue also, some people will go after you. How can you do it? There's no way that you should have done it. So my humble submission to you is, don't consider that when you don't charge anything, it is not to be reported. Even when you don't charge anything from a related party, you have to report it. When there is a transfer of a resource or obligation. But that's important. There should be a transfer of resource or obligation. The definition of the control under this particular standard is different from the definition given under AS-21, that is the consolidation, in one way. AS-21 talks of control through the capital, that's 50% plus 1. Control through the composition of the board, that's also. But that does not talk of anything else. But here it talks of another thing. Where you have the significant influence, either through the agreement or otherwise, it is very much possible that the two institutions combine and you say that you will not be able to appoint CFO or the chairman of governing body without my permission. You will not be able to introduce any other course without my permission. It is a related party transaction because there is a significant influence which is being exercised by way of an agreement. If there is an agreement in which one can veto the decisions of the others, it becomes a related party. It becomes a case of significant influence, and in that particular case, any related party transaction between the two has to be reported. Yeah, please.
Mention knowledgeable partners.
Knowledgeable buyers. But yes, I'll tell you.
Knowledgeable partnership.
Knowledgeable partnership. I said knowledgeable seller and buyer.
Yes, knowledgeable seller.
What can happen is the person is sitting in London and he wants to sell a property in Delhi and he does not know what is the actual rate of the property and he sells it. No, that is not a knowledgeable buyer or seller. You may be a knowledgeable buyer, but he is not a knowledgeable seller. Because that's not an arm's length transaction then.
Both should be knowledgeable.
Both should be knowledge. Must be having the knowledge of the market conditions.
Okay, sir. Sir, most of the organizations have signed MOU with different institutes and organizations. And they have collaborative projects also, where resources are shared and obligations are also shared. In that situation, whether it is required to be disclosed or it is only just MOU?
If it is a joint venture for the purpose of making certain economic benefits, it is a related party transaction. 100% it is a related party transaction. If you have told somebody, okay, we will find out, we will do some research together, and the benefits of this research will be shared by both of us. So it is an economic gain which you want to share. Now, whatever resources you transfer amongst yourselves, that has to be treated as a related party transaction without fail. Ye hoga. I think this will be there, particularly IIM walon ke saath to kafi hoga.
But there are foreign collaborative projects.
Whatever it is.
Where the resources are shared between the organization in India and other countries also.
Provided there is an MOU as a joint venture, I am again saying. Or it is an associate. In that case, whatever resources you share, either with consideration or without consideration, that will have to be disclosed.
If our scientist or the academician goes abroad, gives lecture,
yeah,
and there is an MOU and collaborative project going,
yeah,
on,
yeah,
then also it is to be...
Yes, if you don't charge, then also, and if you charge, then also. No, please. I think you are missing out the point. One is that you have the arrangement that you will send your person on exchange program under the exchange. Then it is not a joint venture. Please try to appreciate.
Some project is there.
If there is a project in which there are a certain research is being carried out and the findings of that research will be used by both of you for your economic gains, 100% it will fall under that category. You cannot avoid.
Government sector universities have a social mandate. So they and these arrangements need not be necessarily for economic gain.
So I will only tell you one thing.
So because of that social mandate.
I will only tell you one thing. This standard provides certain exceptions.
Yes.
Which are not there as a part of the slides, but I wanted to tell you. Yeah. One is that if there are transactions between the two government departments, most state of or central.
Yes.
But if it is a foreign one, then it is no more a...
Between two governments also, because science and technology agreements between two different countries facilitate exchange of
very students. Frankly, yeah, it does not talk of foreign government department and Indian government department. It only talks of the Indian government department, if you ask me. But if you particularly, I can say that even if I look at the interpretational issue, if you are dealing with the Indian government, with the foreign government, you can still say both are the governments. And we cannot influence somebody to pay more or less. So it can be still treated as arm length and probably you can claim exemption. Even if by way of interpretation, you have to really claim it. But if it is not a government department, and if it is a party, or if it is a company abroad, then what do you do? In that case, it is a joint venture, nothing more, nothing less. This particular standard provides exemption where there are transactions between one central government department with another central government department, one central government department with the state government department, one state government department with the state government department. Then you need not disclose the related party transaction, because otherwise what is going to happen is that President of India owns shares in IOC, IOC deals with ONGC, then those transactions are not to be disclosed. Because in both the cases, it is the government which is involved basically. Both are government companies. So you need not disclose that. But if Indian Oil deals with Jindals, which is happening today, if you ask me, ONGC deals with Jindals, NTPC deals with JP, then that will be considered to be a joint venture and the transactions will have to be disclosed. Listed, but then both are government companies, no? Still the auditors are appointed by C&AG. More than 50% shares are held by the government. These are government companies.
But shareholders have the right to
But that exception has been provided by the standard. I can't help, you cannot help. Let's be clear. And if it is a case of trade union may be able to influence your decision, but it is not considered to be a related party. Provider of finance, bank, may be able to influence your decision, but he is not considered to be your related party. You might be purchasing the entire material from a one particular supplier. He will not be considered to be a related party. You might be supplying everything to one customer. He will not be considered to be your related party. These are the exceptions which are built in within the accounting standard for that purpose. What one is trying to tell you is that in those cases, whichever cases one has given you, you need to go ahead with this and the disclosures have to be made. There are certain things which you have to keep in mind. I said if it is 20% more, then it is considered to be significant influence. But it is a rebuttable presumption. You can very well say that I hold 20% shares, but I am not even getting a seat on the board. Not even a single seat on the board. So how can I influence the decision? And if you can prove it, you will not be considered to be a related party transaction. On the other side of it, now I am going to give you a very good example. On the other side of it, you have less than 20% of the holding, but nothing moves without you. In that case, it will be considered to be a related party transaction. There are groups in India, in corporate world, where they don't have 20% holding. They only have about 8 to 13% of the holding, but without them, nothing moves in their group companies. I don't want to name anybody. I think if you look at Tatas are a class example. They don't control by 51%. I don't think in any of the companies they have 51%. But look at their holdings through the Tata Sons. What is the level of holdings in the different companies? But they will be considered to be related parties. So what is important to be understood is that there are cases where you may hold less than 20% and still it will be a related party transaction. In certain cases, you may hold more than 20% and still it will not be considered to be a related party transaction, depending upon how you are able to argue out your case. And the other thing which is not applicable to you, if it is a relationship of a holding and subsidiary, in that case, irrespective of the fact whether there is a transaction carried out between the two, you still have to disclose the names of the two. Holding company will disclose the name of its subsidiaries. Koi transaction nahi hui hai. No transaction has taken place, but still they will disclose the names of the subsidiaries. And the subsidiary will disclose the name of the holding company, irrespective of the fact whether any transaction has taken place or not. But in the case of the joint venture, associate, key managerial personnel, and the relatives, you will disclose not the names till the time the transaction has taken place. In the holding subsidiary relationship, you will disclose the names even if no transaction is there. But in the case of the others, you will disclose only when the transactions have taken place. So this part you should be able to remember very clearly. And the other part that you have to be very clear is, you look at the paragraph 23-25, what it requires you to disclose. If you look at the disclosure, it says, please disclose the names of the related parties, transactions, the nature of the transactions with the related parties, purchase, hai, sale, hai, what it is, whatever it is, please disclose that. But you should not be able to camouflage. What people were doing recently was that they sold out certain goods and they included the sale of even asset in that sale. You cannot do that. Purchase of the general merchandise is different and purchase of a fixed asset is different. These are two different categories. If you purchase a fixed asset, it is different. If you purchase the general merchandise, it is different. You have to give what is the percentage, what is the amount and percentage of the total sale. If out of 100, you have purchased 80 from the same party, it is serious, no? Everyone should be looking at it with some kind of a suspicion. Okay, why? And whether this 80 is a fair value or not. And particularly if there is a bad debt in the related party. Bad debt, tum aap samajhte, what is a bad debt? If you are unable to recover certain amount from a related party, that has to be disclosed. Even if you create a provision in respect of a bad debt, in respect of the related party, That has to be disclosed separately.
But it is possible in case of vertical combination of companies. When a company has the vertical combination, it has production unit, it has raw material unit and all, then they have to purchase the raw materials from their
vertical. Vertical combination to aapke apni company mein hi ho gaya na, then it is not related party, then it is inter group, rather you can say segmental transfer. I think what you are talking is, but if it is a case of forward integration, backward integration. Tata set up something as Tata Teleservices, and Tata also set up a particular company for purchase and sale of the mobile sets. But if these two companies deal with each other, these are related party transactions. Let's be clear about it. Vertical or horizontal is not important. And if Tata, if X and Y are related parties, and X in its books of account says that bad debt, written off, and it is in respect of Y, the public must know, na?
That's a camouflaging.
You just cannot write off something from your own related party where you control.
That is manipulation of account.
So manipulation. Similarly, even if you create a provision for a doubtful debt, it has to be told. Not only that, it says, suppose you had earlier written off a bad debt, and in this year you have affected the recovery of a bad debt, that has also to be disclosed.
That impact on tax.
Impact on the, tax. Naturally the reader should be able to understand what has happened in the financial statements. That's the reason. And more importantly, paragraph 23.5 probably talks of something which is very important. It says, and any transaction the element of which needs to be understood. And then the example it gives in paragraph 25, and what does it say? It says if an asset was having a book value of 100 and it has been transferred to a related party at 75, that needs to be disclosed. This is very significant. If an item which was having a book value of 100 has been transferred at 70 or 75, that needs to be disclosed. But what I am only able to tell you is, if 100 rupee item is transferred at less than 100 to a related party, it needs to be disclosed as per the requirements of the accounting standard.
Or in multiple 100 rupees is transferred at 1000.
At 1000, that also. Because what will happen is, the person who is purchasing, and if actually its value is 100 and he has purchased it for 1000, it needs to be disclosed by him, na? As a related party transaction. So all that needs to be done. This is what this standard is. There's nothing else in this standard. And this standard I have done fully. I have not left anything so far as this standard is concerned.
Why it is that 100 rupees, 100 cost item that is sold at less than 100? In that case, will that party be considered as knowledgeable party or not?
And?
Knowledgeable party or not?
Because knowledgeable party. Knowledgeable party. Why not?
Because earlier you said that the person living in a...
Please try to appreciate. What I said was, I defined arm's length transaction. I defined arm's length transaction. Here we will say it is not arm's length transaction.
Yeah. But earlier a person living in UK, he wanted to...
There is a difference. There is a difference. Here what I am saying is, if knowingly I am purchasing 100 rupees item at 75, yeah, or I am transferring 100 rupees item at 75, in any case the person who is transferring 100 rupees item at 75, he knows it in the books. See, here who is sufferer? Sufferer is seller?
Seller, yes.
And seller knows that the book value is 100?
In that case also, the person living at UK is also a sufferer, no?
The person selling in UK did not know what is the price, please, that is what I said.
But something, I think, something has to be...
No, no. Suppose he thought that the price is a crore, but actually the price was 3 crores. That is why his knowledge was poor. But here the seller knows that my book value is 100. There is a difference. So thank you very much, friends, for a very, very patient hearing. My gratitude to you.